bên chơi tôi cho. Ông chưa nói chuyện đây, sẽ là tập bùng, các vận to cách đầm nà ca, nị tệ vị thi, sạm nà ca. Hay môn nâng chiên cho đò đầm nà ca đập sạc khay cam đó bò, nẹt chùm niên bẩn đất, Craig Etcheson, ông chuyện đây. ສະຫຼາດຕະບົງສົງປະກາດໃນສັກໃດສໍາຫຼັດເລືອກການຈຸມຕົວໄດ້ບານເລືອກຫຼັງໂດຍມິດວີການປຽຈິນຕຽບຈາດປີປຶກມິ່ງໂດຍຂ້າງກ້ອມອັງຈຸມນຸມຈຸມແດສະຫຼາດຕະບົງມັນຈອບອັດຕະປະກິດຕື່ນຶງສັກໃດແນ່ນໍາຫຼືການຈົງອົນບັງຫານໄດ້ບານປະກົນຕື່ອ້ອຍພິກີຈອມປູ້ວິຊາລະພິບໃນການພັດດອສັກໄຂກໍາ ឬរបាយការណ៍របស់អ្នកជំនាញនោះទេដោយហេតុថាអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងនិងភិក្ខីមានសិទ្ធិក្នុងការសួរសំណួរដល់អ្នកជំនាញក្នុងករណីដែលអង្គជំនះសាលាដំបងយល់ឃើញថាសំណួរទាំងនោះមានភាពពាក់ព័ន្ធនៅពេលឆ្លើយទៅនឹងសំណួរទាំងនោះ អ្នកជំនាញមិនត្រូវបានចងភ្ជាប់ទៅនឹងរបាយការណ៍ឬសេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍ជាលិលាអសរដែលបានដាក់ពីមុននោះទេអ្នកជំនាញមិនមាននៅកាតព្វកិច្ចក្នុងការដាក់នៅរបាយការណ៍ជាលិលាអសរបន្ថែមនោះទេជាទូទៅដើម្បីដាក់ឯកសារនៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនុំជម្រះរាល់ឯកសារទាំងអស់ត្រូវតែមានជា3ភាសា របស់តុលាការប៉ុន្តែអង្គជំនុំជម្រះនិងទទួលយកនៅការយោងទៅលើឯកសារទាំងឡាយណាដែលមានជាភាសាខ្មែរនិងភាសាផ្លូវការមួយទៀតរបស់តុលាការដោយហេតុថាក៏អ្នកនិយាយភាសាខ្មែរមាននៅក្នុងក្រុមភាគីទាំងអស់និងនៅក្នុងអង្គជំនុំជម្រះ សាលាដំបងផងដែរខធនធាននៃការបកប្រែនៅមានកម្រិតហើយមានឯកសារជាច្រើនក្នុងសំណុំរឿងដែលត្រូវបកប្រែគយោងតាមវិធាន21អង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងមានកាតព្វកិច្ចក្នុងការរៀបចំដំណើរការសកម្មភាពប្រកបដោយភាពយុត្តិធម៌និងបញ្ចប់ក្នុងរយៈពេល1ដែលសមស្រប មានករណីលើកលែងចំពោះវិធាននេះដែលករណីមួយនៃការលើកលែងនេះគឺក្នុងករណីដែលឯកសារត្រូវលើកឡើងហើយមិនបានជូនដំណឹងជាមុននោះភាគីអាចជំទាស់ទៅនឹងភាពអាចទទួលយកបាននៃឯកសារនោះឬអាចស្នើសុំពន្យាទៅសុំពេលវេលាបន្ថែមដើម្បីធ្វើការពិនិត្យពិចារណាលើឯកសារនោះបាន រាល់ការបកប្រែទាំងអស់នឹងត្រូវបានទទួលយកដោយតុលាការលើកលែងតែមានការជំទាស់ទាក់ទងនឹងភាពត្រឹមត្រូវនិងភាពស៊ីសង្វាក់គ្នារវាងឯកសារទាំងនោះការលើកឡើងនៃការជំទាស់នោះត្រូវមានមូលហេតុច្បាស់លាស់តុលាការសូមរំលឹកដល់ភាគីថាឯកសារដែលរួមបញ្ចូលទាំងឯកសារ ដែលលើកឡើងដោយអ្នកជំនាញត្រូវតែបានអានឬសង្ខេបដើម្បីយកមកពិចារណានៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសេចក្តីសម្រេចការជំទាស់ដែលបានលើកឡើងដោយមេធាវីការពារជនជាប់ចោតតាក់ទងនឹងវិសាលភាពនៃការធ្វើសក្តិកម្មរបស់អ្នកជំនាញ Craig Etcheson ដែលថាគាត់គួរតែដាក់នៅរបាយការណ៍បន្ថែម ហើយដែលថាការបកប្រែមិនបានធ្វើឡើងដោយអង្គភាពបកប្រែរបស់អង្គជំនុំជម្រះក្នុងតុលាការកម្ពុជានោះត្រូវបដិសេធចោល ឯកសារដេ56ដែលគេស្គាល់ថាជាចម្លើយសារភាពរបស់ចាប់នោមមិនមានការបកប្រែជាភាសាបារាំងហើយការលើកឡើងនៅឯកសារនោះធ្វើឡើងដោយមិនបានដឹងជាមុនមេតវីការពារជាចាប់ចោតអាចជ្រើសរើសក្នុងការស្នើសុំពេលវេលាបន្ថែមដើម្បីពិនិត្យ លើឯកសារនោះឬអាចឆ្នោតសុំបដិសេធមិនអោយទទួលយកនៅឯកសារនោះក្នុងដំណាក់កាលនេះបានអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងនឹងស្នើសុំដល់មេធាវីការពារជំនប់ចោតអោយធ្វើការចង្អុលបង្ហាញដោយផ្អែកតាមសេចក្តីសម្រេចនេះថាតើក្រុមរបស់ខ្លួនរក្សានៅជំហរក្នុងការបដិសេធទៅនឹងឯកសារយោងលេខ ដេ2ដប5ឧបសម្ព័ន្ធកនៃសេចក្តីសន្និដ្ឋានបញ្ជូនរឿងឲ្យស៊ើបសួរឯកសារលេខ39និង30ដែរឬទេដោយធ្វើការបញ្ជាក់លើឯកសារយោងទាំងនេះនិងប្រសិនបើក្រុមរបស់ខ្លួនរក្សានៅជំហរក្នុងការបដិសេធលើឯកសារទាំងនេះសូមបញ្ជាក់នៅមូលហេតុនៃការជំទាស់នេះឲ្យបានច្បាស់លាស់ត្រឹមម៉ោង9ព្រឹកថ្ងៃ ស្អែកនេះជាសេចក្តីសម្រេចលើការជំទាស់របស់មេធាវីការពារជនជាប់ចោតដែលបានលើកឡើងពីព្រឹកមិញសូមអញ្ជើញលោកប្រង់សរុ
Oui, Monsieur le Président. Une précision a demandé à Monsieur l'expert. L'avant-dernier document qui est cité dans sa liste, il est indiqué numéro 39. Est-ce que ce numéro fait référence à une note de bas de page du rapport de l'expert ou un autre numéro parce que nous ne l'avons pas comme note de bas de page. Donc, quel est ce numéro 39 ? À quoi ça fait référence ?
Je voudrais comprendre. Si
Monsieur le juge a
compris.
Je parle sous le contrôle de l'expert, mais il me semble que le numéro 39 est le numéro 39 de l'annexe C du réquisitoire introductif. Donc ce ne correspond pas à un numéro de bas de page, mais à un numéro dans l'annexe du réquisitoire introductif.
Dans le rapport à la note de bas de page 59, mais à la date du 10 septembre 1978. Tandis que dans l'annexe, cette confection
était
à la date du 25 octobre 1978. Donc j'ai besoin d'éclaircissement. Il faut être sûr si nous parlons bien de la même confession. À moins qu'il y ait deux confessions. Mais en tout cas, moi,
Dans le document versé
par le procureur,
E55.1
à la page à la page 003
2 1 6 8 0
au numéro 31.
Hay nou krom lech 31
4.2.02 il est marqué
4.1 ke
date de la déclaration 25 octobre 78 Shamsan alias
Chamlai nung ke thngai 25 khai tola 78 robos Chan Som hau si.
Et dans le document d'aujourd'hui
ba ne ke chi avai da men bangkhang pantai nou knong aekasa da ban bangkhang nou thngai ni.
Je n'ai pas la même date.
Voilà.
Je voudrais juste qu'on vérifie si on nous parlons bien du même document.
Thank you, Mr. President. Can I
just
correct
Mr.
Annex C number for that document is 4.02.
Somto 4.02.
Puis je suggérais que l'on poursuive les débats et que l'on demande au bureau des coprocureurs d'apporter d'ici demain des clarifications sur ce document. Et qu'en attendant, on n'y fasse pas référence.
ຈັ່ງດຳເນີນທະປະຍາອາດຖືບານ
Thank you, Mr. President. Yes,
we can do that. Some of the local protests, but that young actor do not ban.
Young actor, the manager, the pizza, the doll, the theatre ban high. Look like the actor, some money, room jam, car, rope, the drug behind the man, the prina, the pill, the top, the batonis, some tune.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Well,
Dr. Etcheson, you've probably forgotten where we are in the bear in mind that we will be making no further reference to any of the three documents that are still under consideration and to which the defence has yet to make comment, and also the document number 39 mentioned in the annex to your overview report. Now, when we stopped earlier today, I was asking you from what other sources S21 received detainees. And I now want to know, please, if there was any particular period when a greater than usual number of district cadre were arrested and brought to S21 for interrogation.
Luke Etcheson.
Yes, Your Honor. If it please the court, I would like to illustrate my answer to this question with reference to two more charts. This morning, I discussed the Office of Co-Prosecutors Combined S21 Prisoner List and gave case file document numbers and EINs for the compilation. And described how we charts and graphs from the information contained in that combined prisoner list. The two additional charts I would like to display before the court at this time are also drawn from analysis of that prisoner list. So if I may proceed with that.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Is there any objection to Dr. Etcheson taking the same approach to this material from any party? Nothing from the prosecutors, anything from any of the civil parties? Thank you. Anything from the defense?
Même observation, madame, il est dommage que ce soit présenté seulement maintenant, alors que le rapport a à peu près deux années de date.
Yes, thank you, the defense will be given the opportunity to consider these charts and make further observations or objections at a later stage. But in the meantime, Dr. Etcheson, could you produce those charts? Do you need to refer again to the ERN numbers and other document numbers from which they are derived, please?
Very well, Your Honor.
Luke Etcheson, Magistrate President, Luke Sajak Krom.
The Office of Co-Prosecutors Combined S21 Prisoner List is case file document number D55. The English language ERN for this document is 0017 23 53 53 through 00 17 22 22 55 55.
Can I just interrupt you at that point, Dr. Etcheson? Seems to be an error in the ERN number. The document starts at 0017 23 53 and ends in description at 253, something rather after that. It doesn't go backwards,
we assume.
You're quite right, Your Honor. I have an error in my information here. Because I have drawn these ERN numbers from the Office of Co-Prosecutors Case Management System, we may have a bad piece of data in that case management system. I'm afraid I
can't provide a correction at this point with the resources that you have.
Well, perhaps if I ask the Office of Co-Prosecutors to give us this information when they can, please. Thank you.
It is one mistyped digit. It should read 00172353 through 00172355. And this document, in fact, is the written record of this witness's statement exhibiting his written report, which explains why it only appears to cover three pages rather than the entirety of his report. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Can you continue now, Dr. Etcheson?
Yes, Your Honor. Excuse me for that confusion. With the assistance of the audiovisual unit, could we please put my laptop on the screen? Again, this chart is based on an analysis by the Office of Co-Prosecutors of the combined S21 prisoner list, which is on the case file and which I have previously mentioned. This chart shows that purges of CPK cadres were carried out in all zones of democratic Cambodia. In some zones, however, the purges were much more severe than in other zones. In particular, especially severe purges were carried out in the Old North Zone, which is also known as the Central Zone, in the East Zone, and in the Northwest Zone. When the Chamber has had adequate time to examine this exhibit, I'm prepared to move to the next chart, which goes into more detail.
Yes, thank you. I think you can move on now, Dr. Etcheson.
This next chart compares the purges in the central, northwest, and east zones as measured by arrests at S21. This chart is also based on data from the Office of Co-Prosecutors' combined S21 prisoner list. This chart shows that the purge of the central zone peaked in the second quarter of 1977. The purge of the northwest zone got underway in the third quarter of 1977 and continued into the first quarter of 1978. The purge of the east zone was extremely rapid. It peaked in the second quarter of 1978. More than 1,000 cadres from the east zone and more than 1,000 cadres from the northwest zone were sent to S21 in the course of these purges. Many of those cadres were from the district level. So to return to your original question, this graph shows a period when there was a very high concentration of district cadres being sent to S21.
Yes, thank you. That is the those are the only two charts you want to show to us, Dr. Etcheson?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Thank you. Well, perhaps AV can return our screens to normal position, please.
Madame le juge? Pourrions-nous disposer d'une copie aussi rapidement que possible de ces graphiques et qu'il me soit quand même permis une observation? Nous avons parlé pendant des semaines et des mois avec le bureau des coprocureurs pour établir une liste des faits reconnus par l'accusé. Ne croyez-vous pas qu'il aurait été intéressant de communiquer à la défense de tels documents, au demeurant très utiles? Pourquoi attendre le jour même de la déposition de l'expert? Ça n'est pas ma conception d'un procès contradictoire. Par ailleurs, madame, permettez-moi de rectifier une petite erreur commise par mon confrère Alex Batt. La cote D55 n'est pas un procès-verbal d'interrogatoire de M. Greg Etcheson. La cote D55 est une demande des coprocureurs adressée au co-juge d'instruction le 19 mars 2008, il y a plus d'un an, demande des coprocureurs en vue d'admettre la liste des prisonniers de S21. Hein? Voilà exactement le titre de la cote D55. Cette requête contient effectivement trois pages et il y a par contre l'annexe A qui, elle, contient 370 pages. Et j'imagine que c'est à partir de ces 370 pages qui constituent la liste des prisonniers que M. l'expert a pu établir ces deux tableaux. Voilà. Et donc, j'aimerais que nous ayons aussi vite que possible une copie de ces tableaux. Mieux vaut tard que jamais.
Yes, I see an indication from the international co-prosecutor that that will be done by as soon as possible. Can you give an indication?
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. If all the defense requires is a copy of what was shown in the original language, we can do that by tomorrow morning. If the defense wish copies of it translating into both the other languages, that will take a week.
And I stand corrected. Thank you.
Yes, well, Mitchell, we'll make sure that you have at least the charts that were shown today by tomorrow morning and translations as soon as possible thereafter. Do you require translations? Because there wasn't a lot of interpretation needed in these particular cases.
Je pense que nous pouvons nous contenter de des graphiques tels qu'ils sont, ça n'est pas la peine de surcharger le service de traduction.
Thank you for that indication. It's very helpful. Now, Dr. Etcheson.
Craig Etcheson.
I would like to compare the situation at S21 with other special security prisons, and I'd like to know if there were any other special security prisons that received such a wide range of detainees.
No, Your Honor, I don't believe so. Democratic Kampuchea security offices were empowered to arrest persons within their own area of operations, so that, for example, the Sector 103 security office was authorized to arrest anyone within Sector 103. The Southwest Zone Security Office was empowered to arrest anyone within the Southwest Zone, and so on. But S21's area of operations was nationwide. S21 was the only security office with the authority to arrest and detain people from across the entire country.
In his testimony, the accused
said that S21 was the tool of the Standing Committee, and he attributed that partly to the fact that it was located in Phnom Penh. Do you have any comment to make on that?
Yes, indeed.
Look, Craig Etcheson, the
Party Center was known as the Party Center because that is where national power at the very apex of the organizational hierarchy was concentrated. The security office that was associated with this penultimate node in the power pyramid
And in the statement of agreed facts at paragraph 21, the Office of Co-Prosecutor said this: S21 was an integral part of the politico-military structure of the CPK at the center level, referred to variously as ANCAR, the organization, the Party Center, the Central Committee, or the Standing Committee. And that refers to paragraph 32 of the closing order, and the accused noted that he partly agreed to that statement and made the following additional comment. In Deutsch's view, it would be more accurate to say that S21 was managed by the Standing Committee of the Central Committee rather than at the center level. It would have been possible to assert that S21 was at the center level if Doik himself had been part of the Standing Committee of the Central Committee, but he was not. Do you have any comment to make on the refinements to the accused's response to paragraph 66 of the agreed facts?
It seems to me, Your Honor, that
this is a very fine distinction indeed. For my own understanding of the facts, I think agreed fact number 66 is correct as stated. We know that the accused person was not a member of the Standing Committee.
Thank you. Were those sent to and detained at S21 different as a class to those detained at other prisons around Cambodia? By class, I mean different group as opposed to a political meaning of class.
Yes, Your Honor. I think it's fair to say that. For example, in his own statements to the co-investigating judges, the accused person has said that only S21 had the authority to interrogate members of the Central Committee and of the Standing Committee of the Communist Party of Cambodia. I don't have a precise ERN reference for that assertion, but it is on the case file and the statements that the accused person has made to the co-investigating judges. Moreover, if you look closely at the Office of Co-Prosecutors Combined S21 Prisoner List, you will see that this pattern holds more generally. Leading cadre from the zone, sector, and district echelons, along with ranking military leaders and ranking leaders of government ministries, almost invariably ended up at S21 when they were purged. I have seen no evidence that would suggest this was the case with any other security office in Democratic Cambodia. All of the most important prisoners, which is to say the highest ranking prisoners in the political and military hierarchies, were sent to S21.
Thank you. Did other chairmen of special security prisons report directly to Son Sen or any other minister?
Your Honor, this is a particularly difficult question. I am aware of certain evidence that is relevant to this question. But that evidence is in case file 2, which is currently the subject of a judicial investigation by the Office of Co-Investigating Judges. As you know, judicial investigations are confidential. So I am not at liberty to describe that evidence in any detail here today. However, I believe I can say that none of that evidence suggests the kind of direct, personal, daily reporting relationship that the accused person had with Son Sen and the new chair existed with respect to any other Democratic Cambodia security
office. Thank you, Dr. Etcheson. I want to turn now to the Constitution of Democratic
Cambodia,
which the reference to which is in the English ERN number 0018-4833 to
0041 to 0089 8841 to 0089 8852.
I have no reference to a French version of the document. You have a reference? Thank you. Can you give it to me, please?
Yes, Your Honor. the ERM for the French language version of the Constitution of Democratic Cambodia is 00 02 6 24 44 through 00 01 01 02 6 59 59.
Now, under Chapter 5 of that Constitution, a legislative body to be known as the Kampuchean People's Representative Assembly was established. From your research, are you able to say if this legislative body ever met?
Yes, Your Honor. It's my understanding that the People's Representative Assembly
met
once between 11 and 13 April 1976. That also corresponded with the time when the People's Representative Assembly was constituted.
And are you able to say whether the 250 members of that representative assembly were appointed or elected?
It is clear, Your Honor, that they were appointed by upper echelons of the Communist Party of Cambodia.
Thank you. Under Chapter 6 of the Constitution, an executive body was to be elected by the Cambodian People's Representative Assembly. Was that executive body ever elected or established?
The executive body of the Democratic Cambodian State was indeed established. And if you examine the minutes from 1976 that the Standing Committee went through to constitute these organs of the state. Never an election per se by the People's Representative Assembly. What the People's Representative Assembly in fact did was vote unanimously in favor of the organs that were presented to them.
And in Chapter 7 of the Constitution, people's courts were anticipated with judges chosen and appointed by the Cambodian People's Representative Assembly. Were those people's courts established and judges appointed?
On the case file, Your Honor, there is a document entitled Document on Conference 1 of Legislature 1 of the People's Representative Assembly of Cambodia, 11 through 13 April 1976. This document is actually dated 14 April 1976, and it has the ERM 00 18 40 48 through 00 18 40 4078 at ERN00 18 4078 in this document. It says the People's Representative Assembly has, and I quote, decided to approve the selection and appointment of a judicial committee with Kang Chap as chairman.
End quote.
However, in the standing committee meeting
minutes dated 8 March 1976,
with the ERN 00 18 26 B 6 B 6 through 00 18 26 B 6 3 4 at ERN 00 18 26 B 6 2 9 B 9, the standing committee notes as follows, and I quote, "We do not set up an election in the capitalist style. We use the dictatorship of our proletariat class." And then it goes on to say, representatives must be selected at upper echelon. So the standing committee appointed a senior cadre, Kang Chap, as chairman of a judiciary committee. There is no evidence that I have seen anywhere that the Judiciary Committee ever convened or took any action to establish courts, people's courts, or otherwise. The chamber has directed that we should not discuss the S-21 confession of Chen Song, alias Sai, at this time. So I will just note in passing that there may be additional relevant information for your question in that confession.
Thank you. Now, under Chapter 8 of the Constitution, a state presidium was to be chosen and appointed by the Kampuchean People's Assembly. Was it ever established?
Yes, Your Honor.
The
state presidium was established. However, as with the other organs we have discussed, in fact, the state presidium was appointed by the standing committee of the Communist Party of Kampuchea, and the purported election of the presidium, or actually the Constitution says that the People's Representative Assembly will choose the state presidium. The nature of that choice, in fact, was to merely ratify the presidium candidates who were put forward by the standing committee.
Thank you. I now want to ask for your comments on a few matters raised by the accused in his testimony. He said that CPK policy was absolute. Do you agree with that?
The word
absolute
was an ideological term of art within the Communist Party of Cambodia. And it referred to the degree of commitment of a cadre
of
the policy lines of the party or the degree of sacrifice
a cadre was willing to offer to the revolution
or to the intensity of policy directives put forward by the senior leadership of the party. In that strict ideological sense, there was much that was absolute about the Khmer revolution.
The accused also said that at S21, people who were arrested and presumably detained there could never be released. In your research, can you confirm or otherwise comment on that statement?
Mr. Etcheson.
It appears to me, based on my research into the history of S21, that prior to the time the accused person became chairman of S21, under the previous secretary of S21, that it was not uncommon for prisoners to be released. After the accused person became the secretary of S21, it seems that release of prisoners became much less common. Indeed, very rare statistically speaking, but it is not true that no one was ever released.
The accused also said that he had no right to release anyone from S21. Do you have any comment?
I
suspect that was probably true.
And he further went on to say that Pol Pot himself had no power to release anyone. Do you have any comment on that?
I don't know how to respond to that comment, frankly,
Your Honor.
Much of our understanding of how the Standing Committee of the Communist Party suggests that they operated through the principles of collectivism and democratic centralism, which means that policy decisions were discussed and then decided, and then everyone was bound by the decision. But it also seems that Pol Pot, as secretary of the party and as a politician, was a very persuasive individual. So it is difficult for me to imagine that if he wished for someone to be released from S21, that he could not somehow arrange for that to happen.
Again, in his testimony, the accused said that the central office held confidential documents, some of which the accused noted he had not seen until comparatively recently and during the investigation, and he put them into three classes. The first, the most confidential, the second, internal party documents, for example, statutes, and if you were not a member, a full rights member of the party, you could not read or discuss those documents. And finally, open documents, such as the Revolutionary Flag Magazine, the Constitution of Democratic Cambodia, and radio broadcasts. He then went on to say that what he and others in his situation did was based on orders rather than documentation. Do you have any comment to make on those statements?
All states, Your Honor, and indeed many large organizations have elaborate policies for the classification of sensitive and confidential information. One of the characteristics we have observed about the Communist Party of Cambodia and correspondingly the State of Democratic Cambodia is that they had a quite extreme policy on secrecy for a very wide range of topics. Indeed, such that for nearly 2.5 years after this party seized state power, they refused to publicly acknowledge that their Communist Party even existed. This was a devotion to secrecy which was unparalleled in the history of communist movements throughout the world. ខ្លួនឯងតែមិនដែលមានទេនៅក្នុងប្រវត្តិសាស្ត្រពីមុនមកតើតើទៅនឹងបកគំនិតនេះហើយដូចជាការមួយធ្វើឲ្យភាពអាបំផុតនៅពេលដែលយើងពិនិត្យមើលបាទបើប្រៀបធៀបទៅនឹងបកគំនិតដទៃទៀតនៅលើពិភពលោកដូច្នេះយើងអាចមើលឃើញថាជាភាពប្រកបប្រជានេះថាបកគំនិតកម្ពុជាប្រកបជាមានសិស្តមប្រព័ន្ធមួយក្នុងការធ្វើការបែងចែកបាទព័ត៌មាន
The accused also said in his testimony that no part of the policy of, quote, smashing went through the courts. Do you agree with that statement?
Yes, as I suggested when you asked me about the judiciary in relation to the Constitution, there is no evidence that there was any such thing as a court in Democratic Cambodia.
Thank you, Dr. Etcheson. Mr. President, I have no further questions of Dr. Etcheson at this point.
Il s'agit plutôt d'une précision que je souhaiterais obtenir de la part de l'expert à une des questions de Madame le juge Cartwright. Concernant la politique mise en œuvre à S21 et le fait qu'il n'était pas possible, qu'il n'y avait pas de possibilité de libérer des personnes détenues à S21. Vous avez parlé d'un changement entre le moment où Nat était à la tête de S21 et le moment où l'accusé a été à la tête du centre. Pourtant, quand vous parlez de S21, vous ne faites référence qu'au centre de détention proprement dit et pas aux établissements annexes tels que Fressar ou S24. C'est la première question. Et ma deuxième question, c'est, vous avez dit qu'il y avait eu un changement, mais pour autant, est-ce que, à votre connaissance, vous savez si, du temps de l'accusé, certaines personnes ont pu ou non être libérées?
មន្ទីរនោះថាតើមាននរណាគេត្រូវបានគេដោះលែងដែរឬទេនៅមន្ទីរសន្តិសុខមួយនោ
ះ Thank you, Your Honor.
Look, Craig Etcheson, សូមអរគុណលោកស្រីចៅក្រម
This is an important distinction
នេះគឺជាការបែងចែករវាងស21និងស24
It's my understanding
តាមការយល់ដឹងរបស់ខ្ញុំ
S24 was under the authority of the accused person and administratively subordinate to S21. However, while S21 was aa torture and extermination facility from which very few people indeed ever emerged alive.
S24
was a re-education camp where many people survived. Our understanding is that there were three categories of prisoners at S24. There were what you might call light offense prisoners. There were serious offense prisoners. And then there was an intermediate category where people were being evaluated to determine if they should fall into the light offense category or the serious offense category. Living conditions at S24 were extremely inhumane. People were subjected to extremely harsh work regimes, lack of health care, inadequate nutrition, beatings, and other forms of physical abuse, so that many people in all three categories succumbed to the extremely harsh regime. But many people who were classified as light prisoners were indeed eventually released from S24 and sent back to their units of organization who have been reformed through labor. Correspondingly, most of the people in the serious offense category did not survive. So, if we consider that S24 was indeed a part of S21, we can see then that many more people than is commonly discussed when referring only to S21 in terms of the main facility, many more people did survive. Does this address the first part of your question adequately, Your Honor? The second part of your question had to do with releases from the main facility at S21 after the accused person became chairman there. We have recently received some new documents from the Documentation Center of Cambodia, and I don't believe they are on this case file.
ខ្ញុំ ជឿ ថា វា មិន ស្ថិត នៅ ក្នុង សំណុំ រឿង នោះ ទេ នៅ ពេល នេះ
which seem to persuasively indicate to me
ឲ្យ យើង ជឿ ថា ហើយ ធ្វើ ឲ្យ ខ្ញុំ ជឿ ថា
several instances
មាន ករណី មួយ ចំនួន មាន គឺ
ទាក់ទង
ទៅ
នឹង
ការ
ដោះ
លែង នៅ មន្ទីរ ស
21
បន្ទាប់ ពី ជន ជាប់ ចោត បាន ក្លាយ ទៅ ជា ប្រធាន ស 21
there was one instance
យើង ឃើញ មាន ករណី មួយ
a large group of soldiers from one of the divisions was sent to S-21 and then 3 days later the vast majority of that group who had been sent to S-21 more than 100 individuals appeared to have been released. I don't have on hand proper references for those documents in terms of ERNs
នៅ ទី នេះ ដើម្បី បញ្ជាក់ អំពី EON នោះ ទេ
ឬក៏
ខ្ញុំ មិន មាន ឯកសារ យោ
hopefully since this information is of an exculpatory nature
ប៉ុន្តែ ចំណុច នេះ វា អាច ជា ចំណុច ដោះ បន្ទុក ទៅ ដល់ ខាង ការពារ ក្តី
proper documentation at this point in time
អញ្ចឹង គឺ វា តាក់ទង ទៅ នឹង ឯកសារ ដែល បាន បង្ហាញ ទៅ លើ ចំណុច នេះ នៅ ពេល នោះ
J'ai une autre question. Vous avez fait état de la possibilité pour les centres de sécurité de procéder à des arrestations. Il me semble que c'est un point qui est en tous les cas contesté par l'accusé s'agissant de S21. Il a toujours dit qu'il y avait une séparation nette entre le pouvoir de détenir des personnes et le pouvoir de procéder à l'arrestation de ces personnes. Alors, est-ce que vous pouvez nous dire si vous avez des éléments précis qui laisseraient penser que notamment l'accusé, avait la possibilité de procéder lui-même à des arrestations. Ou est-ce que, lorsque vous employez ce terme, vous pensez plutôt à des possibilités de détention ?
It is both, Your Honor.
And
I confess to perhaps at times being somewhat imprecise in use of these terms. It seems to me that as the S-21 operation became institutionalized and the function of S-21 became understood throughout the organizational apparatus of the Communist Party and Democratic Cambodia. The ordinary procedure for persons to come under detention at S-21 was for them to be first detained within their own unit of organization. That unit of organization would transport the prisoners to S-21, where it might be more precise to say that they were transferred into the custody of S-21. That was the most common scenario. However, that was not the only scenario. For example, the accused person has described instances where senior leaders were lured under false pretenses to the home or to the office of the accused person, which was within the compound of S-21 and arrested there and subsequently detained at S-21. The accused person has also described for the co-investigating judges at least one instance where forces under his command left the premises of S-21 to effect the arrest of prisoners in other units. I believe there are probably considerably more instances of that happening than the accused person has discussed with us thus far.
ខ្ញុំបន្តនេះសូមជូនវេទិកានេះដល់តំណាងសហប្រញ្ញាដើម្បីមានលទ្ធភាពក្នុងការអាចសួរសំណួរដល់លោកបណ្ឌិតអេចេកសិនដែលជាអ្នកជំនាញប្រសិនបើមានសូមអញ្ជើញតំណាងសហប្រញ្ញា
Thank you, Mr. President.
Alex,
before we start our questions, we wish to raise one issue that has a direct impact on how we ask our questions of this witness, and now seems an appropriate time to raise it. Dr. Etcheson produces 148 documents in his report that have been referred to in list form. As the court is aware and has reminded us all numerous times, by Rule 87.2, I'm sorry, Your Honor, I can hear a noise through my headphones. Thank you, it seems to have stopped. By Rule 87.2, only evidence which has been put before the chamber and subjected to examination can be used to support the final judgment. Additionally, by Rule 87.3, only where the chamber expressly puts before the parties during the hearing, which is requiring the parties to either summarise or read out in court, is that evidence considered put before the chamber? The internal rules provide no guidance on how, in practical terms, in such a large document case as this, how evidence may be read out or how it may be summarised. And the co-prosecutors would seek the Chamber's urgent guidance on this issue, given that it has a direct impact upon the way in which we seek to put questions to this particular witness and to other witnesses who will also provide large quantities of documentary evidence. Now, we have one or two other submissions and suggestions on this issue. If I can first refer back again to the trial management meeting on the 15th of January, Judge Lavergne outlined a suggested practice for the parties who wish to introduce evidence under 87.2. Firstly, according to His Honour, parties should announce their intention to the chamber whilst liaising with the court management service to fulfill all technical requirements. And that comes from the trial management meeting, 15 January, page 65, lines 11 to 18. His Honour went on to say, for instance, preparation of hard copies, indications of portions of documents to be referred to, etc. With the intention, it appears to the co-prosecutors, of requiring, or requesting, should I say, requesting the parties to provide photocopies of every single document upon which or of which they wish to rely on or wish discussed in court. We are here before the chamber asking Dr. Etcheson questions, and the co-prosecutors seek the trial chamber's guidance as to how they can put documents before the court. Obviously, if we were to ask for the reading out of every one of the 148 documents in the witness's report, we would be here for weeks. If we were even to request the reading out of the summaries of each individual document relied on by Dr. Etcheson in his report, we would be here for perhaps many hours, if not a number of days. For the speed and efficiency of this trial, the co-prosecutors have a suggestion to make and would invite the court to consider it at this stage, given that it is crucial to determine this issue before the parties begin questioning a witness who has so many documents to refer to. The co-prosecutors would suggest this as a way forward. Firstly, any party wishing to rely on documents in fulfilment of rules 87.2 and 87.3 should submit an index of those documents, which contains a summary, a written summary of each of those documents. And then the co-prosecutors would propose that an oral summary be made in court of each document type, rather than summarizing the reading out the summary of every single document. Can I illustrate with reference to Dr. Etcheson's report what the co-prosecutors mean? We have 148 documents. The first two documents are analytical reports. The next five documents, I should say, are biographies. The following four documents are books. There are 24 confessions, two directives, two legal documents, etc. The co-prosecutors would propose that as this index has been already submitted to the trial chamber and circulated to all parties, that we should also request the summaries of document types to be orally read out by us, the co-prosecutors, in fulfillment of 87, Rule 87.2 and Rule 87.3. I pause here just to add one further observation. The documents individually extracted and discussed by this witness are of course important, and it is important to do so,
so
that all parties to these proceedings know exactly which documents are capable of being subject to base the judgment upon. Finally. But if we were to go through every single document, every expert report, we would be taking a vast amount of time to do that. The proposal that we make is that, first, in the first instance, the trial chamber accept these indexes of supporting documents, and that if any party has an objection to any of the documents being used to base the judgment upon, the final judgment upon, then they should make the objection known, and then that objection can be debated before the parties. If I can give one brief example, informal discussions have already taken place between the co-prosecutors and the defence in relation to one particular group of documents, namely media reports. These documents number in the hundreds, and there are in fact summaries of each individual media report. It appears that the defence do not have any in principle objection to the totality of those media reports being summarized in a page. That is the principle that the co-prosecutors wish to be adopted for the other documents that it seeks to put before the chamber. And as I said a few moments ago, if the trial chamber considers the need for efficiency in a large document case such as this, considering also that all parties have the opportunity to object to any specific documents, rights to fair trial are therefore preserved, and of course all parties still have the right to examine the case file throughout these proceedings. I apologise for taking a little time to explain this. It was hoped to file these observations as a written submission, but there are many submissions to respond to at the moment, and I understand that this submission may be filed either later today or tomorrow. But I raise it now because if the trial chamber determines that only those documents which are individually debated before the trial chamber can form the basis of the judgment, then the co-prosecutors will have little alternative but to go through each and every one of Dr. Etcheson's documents, which individually may bear little weight, but collectively they form the expertise that he has been able to provide before the chamber. I hope I've been clear in my submission. If the court has any further questions, I can outline it in more detail. And I hope I've explained why I raise it now before I proceed any further, before we proceed any further.
For my group, it seems to make sense. But of course, if you want us to give a detailed position on exactly how things should happen or whether we are fully comfortable with the way proposed, then we would request just a little time. Maybe tomorrow morning we would be in a position, if we can see the filing, to quickly and early make a submission. And that's the best I can say at that stage.
Thank you, Your Honor. We also would prefer to get the written submission to take a position in detail, and would be able to do this orally. But in general, we support the position of the prosecution that this question, how to put documents or evidence before the chamber, should be resolved and decided before we go ahead to question the expert witness. Thank you.
Monsieur le Président, je m'associe aux précédentes observations des groupes numéro 1 et numéro 2 en ce qui concerne les propositions de messieurs les coprocureurs qui, effectivement, nous semblent dans le bon sens et favorablement. Par contre, j'ai une observation à faire qui me paraît essentielle pour la protection des droits des victimes. Dans la déposition de M. l'expert, à une question qui a lui été posée par M. le juge moderne concernant les libérations en 2021, il a été répondu en présentant un document émanant de DCCAM, document dont il a été dit qu'il n'était pas versé au dossier. Mais l'expert n'y a pas rajouté, en s'adressant à la défense, ça n'est pas gênant, puisque ce sont des documents à décharge. Je viens dire aujourd'hui que c'est extrêmement gênant pour les avocats des parties civiles et que c'est même, je dirais, leur manquer de respect de pouvoir faire état de documents qui ne sont pas dans le dossier, donc pour lesquels nous ne pouvons pas faire d'objection, puisqu'ils n'existent pas, mais dont on peut faire publiquement état, puisqu'ils favorisent la défense. Et alors, où sont les droits pour les victimes et pour les parties civiles, pour les surtout pour les victimes? Je pense qu'il y a, je dirais, une neutralité à observer, pour ne pas dire plus, et un parallélisme des formes. Alors, il y a la question de comment produit-on une pièce, mais il y a aussi la question comment objecter à des pièces qui ne sont pas produites. Parce que le fait que dans les débats, on en parle a obligatoirement
un impact.
Voilà, donc je ne peux pas demander que ces pièces soient retirées puisqu'elles n'existent pas. Vous comprenez
la difficulté.
Voilà. J'estime qu'il y a une violation des droits des victimes. Très respectueusement.
នេះគឺមេថាសិទ្ធិរបស់យើងណាត្រូវបានគេមិនអើពើសូមអញ្ជើញមេធាវីតំណាងឲ្យដើមដំណឹងនេះក្រុមបួនបើសិនជាមានមតិយោបល់ក៏តម្កល់ពាក់ព័ន្ធបញ្ញានេះសូមអញ្ជើញ
សូមសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធានទីក្រុមខ្ញុំមានច្បាស់ជាមេធាវីដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋមេធាវីប្រចាំក្រុមទី4ខ្ញុំបាទមិនមានជាបញ្ហាធំដុំសម្រាប់លើកឡើងទេតែខ្ញុំបាទសូមគាំទ្រទៅដល់ខាងការលើកឡើងរបស់សហប្រជាញ្ញាតែលើកឡើងលើកឡើងអំពីការបំណងនឹងបង្ហាញឬការអានឯកសារទាំង 148 នោះ តែជាកង្វល់ទៅវិញទេដែលខាងខ្ញុំបាទគិតឃើញថាបើសិនជាអានឯកសារទាំងអស់ទីមួយគឺប្រាប់ពេលយូទី2ខាងមេធាវីការពារគាត់បានមានប្រសាសន៍មកហើយថាឯកសារខ្លះដែលលោកមិនទាន់បានដឹងមុនគឺមានការពិចារណាឬជំទាស់ហើយនេះ ជាមតិរបស់ខ្ញុំបាទគឺសូមឲ្យលោកប្រធានសម្រេចថាតើសម្រេចយកឯកសារណាខ្លះឬឲ្យអានតែចំណុចមានERN ដូចនេះឲ្យច្បាស់លាស់ដើម្បីខាងយើងខ្ញុំក៏នឹងមានការកត់សម្គាល់និងមានសំណួរខ្លះៗទៅក្នុងនោះទៅលោកជំនាញផងដែរដូច្នេះសូមលោកប្រធានមេត្តាសម្រេចឲ្យបានច្បាស់សូមអរគុណ
មេធាវីការពារតើមានអ្វីត្រូវកត់សម្គាល់ឬឆ្លើយតបនឹងការលើកឡើងរបស់ភិក្ខុតំណាងសហប្រញ្ញានិងមេធាវីតំណាងឲ្យដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋប្រនីដែរឬទេបើមានសូមអញ្ជើញបាទ
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Monsieur le Président, Madame, Messieurs, nous étions il y a une semaine avec ma consoeur Maître Stulinski, également avec Maître Karim Khan, au séminaire de la Cour pénale internationale en présence de hauts magistrats, notamment M. le procureur Goldstone. Je suis intervenu en indiquant « Je fais un rêve ». Je rêve que devant les juridictions pénale internationale, les procureurs arrêtent de nous inonder de documents parfaitement inutiles. Il y a à peu près 10 années que je fréquente les juridictions pénales internationales. Et c'est toujours la même chose. Des centaines de documents totalement inutiles qui encombrent les tribunaux, qui encombrent les services de traduction parce qu'il n'y a aucune hiérarchie
établi par les procureurs dans l'important par rapport à l'accessoire. Et nous sommes à nouveau dans ce débat. Quand vous réalisez les documents que les coprocureurs voudraient verser à l'appui du rapport de M. Etcheson, en français, on dit ça donne le tournis. Je ne sais pas comment ça se traduit en anglais. Ça donne le vertige. A-t-on vraiment besoin de tous ces documents? Quand on a un expert qui est censé avoir travaillé et qui est censé nous apporter son expertise, a-t-on vraiment besoin de toutes ces références? C'est une très mauvaise habitude qui s'est répandue devant les tribunaux internationaux et qui est en grande partie responsable des longueurs inadmissibles des procès devant les tribunaux internationaux. Dans ma culture juridique, on m'a appris trois qualités. Être clair, net et précis. Vouloir absolument verser au dossier sans aucun tri, comme je le disais, entre l'essentiel et l'accessoire, c'est tout l'inverse d'être clair, net et précis. Et comme je parle ici devant des magistrats qui ont l'habitude des procès, je rappelle la règle 85, police de l'audience. Après consultation des autres juges, deuxième phrase, pardon, je vais commencer par le début. Le président de l'audience dirige les débats et facilite l'intervention des autres juges. Il veille au libre exercice des droits de la défense. Après consultation des autres juges, le président peut exclure des débats tout ce qui tend à les prolonger inutilement sans contribuer à la manifestation de la vérité. Je crois que la solution est beaucoup plus dans ce paragraphe que dans la proposition émise par mes collègues du bureau du procureur. Parce qu'on vous parle de 147 documents, mais on ne vous dit pas le nombre de pages que ça représente. C'est considérable. Est-ce qu'on ne peut pas imposer aux coprocureurs de trier l'indispensable et l'accessoire dans la recherche de sa preuve? Nous avons accepté, comme l'a dit mon collègue,
ce qui concerne les coupures de presse que le bureau des coprocureurs voulait verser concernant le conflit armé, nous avons accepté qu'on ne fasse pas la traduction de ces 200 articles de journaux. Parce que c'est totalement inutile. Et j'ai effectivement dit au bureau des coprocureurs, faites-moi le résumé en une page de ces 200 articles de presse. Mais je faisais un rêve. Mon rêve aurait été que le bureau du procureur, au lieu de verser 200 articles de presse, fasse une sélection des plus importantes et évite d'encombrer la chambre avec des pièces inutile et forcément répétitive. Franchement, avez-vous besoin de 200 articles de journaux pour savoir qu'il y a eu un conflit armé entre le Cambodge et le Vietnam? Vraiment, la Chambre a besoin de 200 articles de presse? Alors, je reviens à ma proposition. Je vous demande, Monsieur le Président, Madame, Messieurs, d'utiliser la règle de l'article 85 en indiquant au bureau des coprocureurs qu'ils doivent faire une sélection et qu'ils ne peuvent pas ensevelir les débats sous des tonnes de documents. Je vous remercie.
Thank you, Mr. President. And I'll just pause so we can all cool down a little. What the co-prosecutors are attempting to do is to short-circuit the very thing that the defence are complaining of. We are attempting to save time and expense by making summaries of documents, a principle that in fact the defence, as I indicated in informal discussions, appears to agree with. The documents in relation to Dr. Etcheson's written record of analysis have been selected from thousands of documents on the case file. It is this expert, Dr. Etcheson, who has determined that these documents are important and relevant. And indeed, there are many thousands of pages contained within these 148 documents. But the proposal of the co-prosecutors is specifically not to inundate this court with paperwork or to insist that all these documents be read out. It is to request the trial chamber for guidance on how best summaries of documents can be put before it under Rule 87.2 and 87.3. We are all in the business of seeing justice done fairly and done expeditiously. And the co-prosecutors do not accept the accusation made by the accused
counsel. We bear the burden of proof. If we put documents before this chamber that the accused does not like, he can challenge them. He can put documents of his own, or he can request the chamber to reject them. But the co-prosecutors submit documents and wish to present evidence that is already on the case file, and we wish to do it in an expeditious and timely manner so that we avoid the very thing that Mr. Hu was complaining of. I make no apology for raising this issue now. I do it, we do it, with a view to saving time in this court and with a view to getting guidance firmly from the trial chamber in how best we can move the proceedings forward quickly. That's all I wish to say, thank you.
Mr.
Oui, je relève que les co-procureurs ont présenté leur requête avant qu'il soit procédé à l'interrogatoire, avant qu'il soit posé des questions à l'expert. J'aimerais savoir si, dans l'esprit des co-procureurs, ils entendent se servir de chacun des 148 documents visé par le requête pour interroger l'expert, ou s'ils entendent simplement se référer à des synthèses, auquel cas il serait peut-être plus facile de présenter des synthèses plutôt que de présenter des documents qui ensuite doivent être évalués, appréciés en tant qu'élément de preuve par la Chambre.
Thank you, Your Honor. That was a very, with respect, timely observation. That is indeed what the co-prosecutors seek. We do not wish to go through each and every one of these 148 documents. To do so would be a waste of time. We wish to select certain of those documents to discuss with the witness, but we also wish to preserve the balance, the other documents within the 148 for use in the court's judgment. And in doing so, to enable that to happen, our understanding of Rule 87.2 and 3 would be, or is, that those documents, even those ones that are not discussed in court, would be required to be summarized. And it was our suggestion that the summarizing process could be even further shortened to save time. It was certainly never our intention to discuss each and every one of the 148 documents.
លោកប្រងសរុត្រូវការប្រើពេលច្រើនទេព្រោះខាងផ្នែកបច្ចេកទេសបានអស់ឌីហើយឌីហ្នឹងគឺមានអំឡុងពេលតែ2-3 មិនិតទៀតឌីថតតែសំឡេងហ្នឹងវាអស់ត្រូវការផ្អាកដើម្បីផ្ដោចំណាយពេលយូរទេអ្នកបច្ចេកទេសអូខេសូមអញ្ជើញ
C'était juste une observation à ce stade de notre réflexion. Qu'est-ce qui est plus intéressant pour nous aujourd'hui dans ce procès? distribuer, commenter des tonnes et des tonnes de documents, ou bien avoir l'opportunité de donner la parole aux victimes et aux parties civiles. Il faut choisir. Il me semble qu'il y a des victimes, il y a des témoins qui peuvent venir dans ce procès, qui attendent de venir dans ce procès, et personnellement, je crois que c'est plus utile que d'inonder la chambre de documents. Voilà ce que je voulais dire.
ឥឡូវនេះដល់ម៉ោង7.7.83 សម្រាប់ថ្ងៃនេះត្រឹមនេះហើយសម្មនាការលើកទៅបន្តនៅថ្ងៃស្អែកដោយស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មរបស់អ្នកជំនាញក្រិចអេកជិកសិនដតដែលនៅវេលាម៉ោង10:30ព្រឹកដោយទុកពេលវេលា1:30ដើម្បីប្រជុំពិភាក្សានិងចេញស្តីសម្រេចមុន ស្ដាប់សក្ខីកម្មរបស់អ្នកជំនាញរូបនេះធ្វើឲ្យដំណើរការសកម្មភាពទៅមុខបានអញ្ចឹងហើយគឺទាមទារពេលវេលាមួយដើម្បីចេញដីសម្រេចនោះអនុរៈមន្ត្រីឃុំឃាំងនាំជនចាប់ចោតទៅកាន់មន្ត្រីឃុំឃាំងវិញហើយឲ្យនាំគាត់មកកាន់ទីនេះនៅព្រឹកថ្ងៃស្អែកឲ្យបានមុនម៉ោង10:30 ចំណែកឯភាគីដែលពាក់ព័ន្ធក៏ដូចក្នុងគ្នាដែរគឺសូមអញ្ជើញឲ្យបាន ដែលលោកបណ្ឌិតក្រេអេកេសិនគឺសូមអញ្ជើញមកកាន់សម្ដាការនៅព្រឹកថ្ងៃស្អែកតាមម៉ោងដែលបានកំណត់អំបញ្ញមិញនេះ